dying. I may be having a diagram about dying and I'll talk about it that time. Wetting of a powder, yeah, that's one more application. Wetting of a powder. You have seen that advertisement, when a tablet is put in that glass of water, it disintegrates immediately instead of staying like that. That happens because the contact angle of water on those particles is small, water can penetrate inside. The same reason why a good paint will stick to a surface, because it penetrates inside. And once the water penetrates inside, it triggers a reaction of the citric acid with caustic soda, no sorry not caustic soda, it will have the baking soda in it, and it will generate carbon dioxide, thereby rupturing those tablets. But it has the same principle of penetration, which is based on the contact angle. And to measure a contact angle on a flat surface, I can put a drop, put a microscope and measure it. But on a powder, I need a special equipment called Washburn analysis. But that is what I use to measure the contact angle on that powder, and it decides whether it is going to get wetted properly or not. It is the same thing which is going to decide whether the painting that I have applied on a transformer, whether over the years the exposure has caused a damage to it or not. Because if the paint loses its hydrophobicity, the water droplet, instead of rolling off, will stay there, and when it stays there, it penetrates, and if it penetrates, it starts corroding the transformer surface and it has damage to the transformer. A lot many transformer people have come to me for this study about how quickly or how long does the paint not get damaged. Get damaged means the contact angle should be high and not low. So many applications that you can think of just on that contact angle, and purely because of that molecular force wanting the water to be together rather than wanting it to be with that solid. It is the preference of the solid, of a liquid molecule to wet the surface vis-a-vis wanting to be with itself, that decides this contact angle. There are very special types of emulsions which are formed, and they are known as micro emulsions. Emulsions require a force to form, and normally emulsions, even if with surfactant, there is a finite surface energy which causes the emulsions to separate out after some time. Maybe sometime means 1 hour, maybe the sometime means few days, maybe it means few months, but eventually it will separate out. Think in terms of an ink, if you have put into that ballpoint pen or a fountain pen if you still use it, and if it settles down those carbon particles to the top or at the bottom while you are writing or you are not writing in the night, it is not a good ink. It's supposed to remain dispersed like that through the few days or months that you are going to use that pen, and through the few months that the ink is going to be stocked on shelf of that shopkeeper. Or if think in terms of the spray that the farmer is putting, the farmer in fact doesn't even have a capability of making any emulsifying equipment, so the emulsion has to form spontaneously when the liquid is poured in the bucket of water. That itself is a technique, spontaneous emulsification, and those spontaneous emulsification droplets should be so small that they will remain suspended in that bucket full of water throughout the day. When the farmer is going to take that bucket on his back and spray throughout in the farm. Otherwise, the pesticide or whatever that material is being sprayed will be settling at the top or at the bottom, and the farmer will be spreading only water. So you want that emulsion to be stable for that longer time. So stability of emulsion is not indefinite. Whereas a micro emulsion, the stability comes out of again the free energy of mixing. The droplets are so small that the number of droplets and the number of molecules of the solvent are now comparable, and the free energy of mixing droplets with the molecules is also now significant. And the surface tension or the interfacial tension between the liquid drop and the surrounding is made so low by use of clever combination of surfactants, that now these two are comparable. And you can form extremely tiny sized droplets there. Not only that, you can form with some force, these actually get formed spontaneously by free energy lowering. So if I bring those components together, that emulsion, the micro emulsion, forms spontaneously rather than me having to spend energy to form it. These micro emulsions can be in three forms. You can have water in oil, oil in water, or bicontinuous. Bicontinuous means like a sponge. In a sponge, if you pull the solid is continuous. But if you blow air through it, air can pass through. That means it is air continuous also. So that is a bicontinuous structure. So like that, you get in microemulsion. Only the dimensionality of these droplets or the bicontinuous chains that I am talking about is below 100 nanometers. As a result, you see it optically transparent. Why? Because optical light or any wave passing through a medium will get obstructed by that medium material only if the size of that medium is at least as large as 1/4 the wavelength of that wave. The minimum visible light wavelength is how much? 400 meters, 400 nanometers or 4000 angstroms, yes. So less than 1/4 of that means less than 100 nanometers. And if these droplets are less than 100 nanometers, optical light will not be obstructed by it and you will think it is transparent and you will in fact think it is a solution. It is easier to distinguish between an emulsion and a microemulsion, more difficult to distinguish between a solution, which is a molecular solution with a solute molecule surrounded by solvent molecules all around, and a microemulsion. Have you ever seen microemulsions anytime? Do you think you have used microemulsions? In fact, it was detected that early 19th century Australian housewives used to use a microemulsion formulation for sheep wool cleaning, because it has hydrophobic dirt as well as hydrophilic dirt, and these microemulsions are very good at dissolving both types of material in it. But the word microemulsion and the discovery of microemulsion was as late as 1943, and the word microemulsion was coined as late as 1959, and the bicontinuous microemulsions were discovered as late as 1976. But Australian housewives of 19th century were using a microemulsion. So same thing will happen to you if I tell you about a product you have used not knowing that it is a microemulsion. Anybody knows that? It will bring back memories from your childhood which are not very pleasant. Dettol, correct. That Dettol liquid is actually a microemulsion. If you put a drop of that in water, it forms an emulsion. But before that, it is a clear, transparent microemulsion. One of the properties for which microemulsions are very commonly used is the aesthetic property that it looks transparent, besides the fact that they are indefinitely stable emulsions. So Dettol is a microemulsion and it spontaneously emulsifies when you pour it in water. It forms that white liquid, similar to the emulsifiable concentrate that the pesticides have to do. Pesticide formulations which are sold as ECs or emulsifiable concentrates, poured by the farmer in that bucket, spontaneously form an emulsion. Or in leather treatment, you have those fat liquors which are sold as the concentrates, and the leather treatment person will actually pour that in water and spontaneously forms a very, very fine emulsion, which then is used for treating the, not, you don't call it a leather yet, you don't call it a hide either. In raw hide, there is a fat material which is natural that is removed, tanning is done, and then refatting of that structure of hide minus fat is what gives you leather. But there also you need those tiny droplets to be formed spontaneously. But sometimes if you make a micro emulsion and pour it in water, it gives a spontaneous emulsion of very fine size. That is what happens with Dettol, that is what happens with that emulsifiable concentrate of pesticide, that is what happens with the emulsifiable concentrate of fat liquors. A micro emulsion can be of any one of these three types. In a normal micelle, there was no core. If I dissolve some molecules in the micelle, I will call it swollen micelle. But a micro emulsion droplet, the skin to core ratio is peculiar, and the skin to core ratio, the volume percent, in a normal emulsion, the skin percentage is less than 0.1%, not even 1.5, that is still too high. In the micelle, the skin is 100%, but in the micro emulsion, you can have either skin is more or the core is more, ranging from 15% to 85% core or skin. So there is a droplet inside, but the size of the droplet is few nanometers. So you cannot call it a homogeneous single phase, but optically it is transparent. So for defining micro emulsion, very precise definition has to be used. We'll see that. And micro emulsions can get formed in a combination of water, oil and surfactant. Typically, if you have too much of surfactant, very little of water and oil, you get liquid crystals. That's the top portion. If you don't have any surfactant, water and oil are immiscible, you get two phases. On the left you have pure water and little bit of surfactant in it, you get micellar solution. If you have oil and an oil soluble surfactant, it will form the reverse micelles there. But if you have high enough surfactant concentration, you can get the two micro emulsions, oil in water, water in oil, or somewhere in the middle of that ternary diagram, you can also get bicontinuous micro emulsions. And these bicontinuous micro emulsions will all be those tubular structures which are there in the continuity of diameter less than 100 nanometers. The oil in water, water in oil droplets less than 100 nanometers, typically between about 10 to 100 nanometers. What it also does is the interfacial area in a normal emulsion will be about 1 centimeter squared per centimeter cube of a liquid. In an emulsion which you create with force, it can go down to about 10 centimeter squared per centimeter cube. But if you create a micro emulsion of that kind of a size that I am talking about, below 100 nm, the interfacial area is like 10 raised to 5, 10 raised to 6 centimeter squared per centimeter cube. So many applications which require high surface area, you can immediately think of with micro emulsions. This is a free energy diagram. Normally, smaller the droplet, more is the surface. More surface means more surface free energy. So smaller the droplet, free energy keeps on increasing. That's what happens in an unstable emulsion. But in the case of a micro emulsion, there is a minimum in free energy that you get. That is because the droplets are so small that the free energy of mixing now becomes important, like in the case of micelle. And there is only a particular size at which that can happen. And therefore, if these micro emulsion droplets coalesce and form a large droplet, they spontaneously break to form two small droplets again. In a normal emulsion, if two droplets coalesce, they will start rising up by creaming process. They will not break up again unless you put a force. In a micro emulsion droplet, without putting any force, the combination droplet will break away because that is what has the lowest Gibbs free energy. A micro emulsion requires a very small interfacial tension. This is some calculation I will skip, but this is a definition of micro emulsion, that it is a single phase. Optically you do not see any two phases, composed of water, a water immiscible oil, surfactant and a co-surfactant. Because the surfactant head groups cannot come very close to each other, I have to put a second molecule which is like a surfactant but not exactly a surfactant, so it's called a co-surfactant, which can go in between two surfactant molecules and prevent the interaction of water from surrounding solvent in that region also, thereby reducing the interfacial tension further. Typically a surfactant, oil and water will have interfacial tension of about 50 millinewtons per meter. If I put a surfactant, that can go down to about 5 millinewtons per meter. But to make a micro emulsion, I require, which is what that calculation was previously, about 0.001 millinewtons per meter. To bring it down to that low, ultra low as it is called, interfacial tension, this second surfactant helps. The surfactant and the co-surfactant is required, and the liquid should be optically isotropic. It should not be directionally dependent properties, and should be thermodynamically stable, not 1 month stability or 2 month stability. As long as there is no chemical decay happening, that micro emulsion will be stable forever. It appears either translucent or transparent to visible light, size in the range of 10 to 100 nanometers. And the criterion we normally say that if it is less than 1/4 the wavelength of visible light, that means less than 100 nanometers, I should call it a micro emulsion. Of course, it should be stable. So these droplets are not really droplets like an emulsion, but they are not individual molecules like a molecular solution. And that is where this nomenclature comes in, which is a very funny nomenclature, because they are called micro emulsions and the size is less than 1/10 of a micron. And that is because at that time micron was the smallest size people used to talk about. Today people talk of a nano emulsion, and that nano emulsion is not this micro emulsion. The nano emulsion is a normal emulsion but beaten so hard with an agitator, with a high pressure homogenizer, that you make droplets by breaking them smaller up to the size of a micro emulsion like 100 nanometers. But that is not a stable emulsion. Given enough time, that nano emulsion will separate out into two phases. That is called a nano emulsion. A micro emulsion, although also of nano size, it is going to be of indefinite stability. That is the difference we have to remember. Now let us see whether this all gets used. Think of any type of industry and you will see why this is relevant. Talk about paints, talk about pharmaceuticals, anywhere where incompatible materials need to be brought together. I am going to give examples from many of these: dyeing, fuels, foods, pesticides, petroleum. Pesticide, I already talked about one aspect there, that the emulsion has to be very stable. Foods, you think foods will not have surfactants in them? You are mistaken. When you eat a bread, the bread has air bubbles, and when that fermentation happens over there, if those bubbles don't get generated and get trapped in that bread structure, you will get a tandoori roti, and that is different structure from the fluffy bread. Same is true about a cake. Same is true about an ice cream. When you eat an ice cream, what usually happens is that when the blob of ice cream, you take it on your tongue, tiny bubbles rupture, and that gives you that tingle which adds taste. Otherwise it would have been kulfi. The difference between kulfi and ice cream is that those tiny bubbles are there. And a trick to know about it is that kulfi is always sold by what units? If I want to buy kulfi, what do I say? Give me one kulfi, two kulfi, or I say 100 gram kulfi, or 100 milliliter kulfi, or how is it kulfi sold? Number of units, okay, but those units are of a particular volume or a particular weight. Kulfi is sold on weight, okay, and the units are made by a particular weight. But ice cream, have you noticed, is it sold on weight? Those ice cream cups, what do they write on it? They write a volume. The reason is, all that volume is not the material. Almost one third to half of those that volume is air bubbles. The density of that ice cream is much less than the density of kulfi, and those air bubbles are essential to give the taste. And naturally, if they have put a lot of air bubbles, they do not want to sell it by weight, but rather sell it by volume, which gives them the advantage of selling air at the cost of, at the price of that ice cream. So in food also, there is a lot of use of these surfactants to make such fine air bubbles. There are food grade surfactants which are used for that. Or for example, when there are any flavor agent which is added, the flavoring agents are molecules which are organic, which are oil soluble but water insoluble. All the foods, just like our body is made of water, foods are mainly water. Even if you think it's a solid food, there is a lot of water in it. So if you want to put a flavor oil, it has to go into the aqueous phase. It will not go without the aid of a surface active agent which will emulsify it well. Food also has a lot of use of surfactants. Let's see some other applications here. In pulp and paper, first of all, when the paper is made, you want to remove some of the unwanted materials, you use a lot of surfactant there. But besides that, when you want to recycle paper, you want to de-ink the paper. Paper de-inking loses a lot of surfactants and microemulsion. Just like resin removal in paper making, de-inking of paper uses surfactants and microemulsion to penetrate into that paper and remove the ink. And mind you, when you are formulating the ink, you have to make it in such a way that those carbon particles are very well dispersed, they are stable, they penetrate into the paper very well. And then when you are de-inking that paper, you have to make a formulation which will take that ink out and make it cleaner. When you talk about metallurgical engineering, many applications. Hydrometallurgy involves what is known as froth flotation, a cheap way of separating gangue material from the ore material. If the ore material is hydrophobic and the gangue material is not hydrophobic, you create tiny bubbles, froth, inside that liquid, and those bubbles attach to the hydrophobic particles. The combined density of the hydrophobic particle and the bubble now is such that it floats in water, and therefore it is called the froth flotation. The combination of the bubble and the particle floats and the gangue material sinks. A very cheap way of separating ore from gangue. Or when you talk about coal storage, you would have heard that there are spontaneous fires in coal mines in Dhanbad, let us say. That happens because coal can burn spontaneously. If you want to prevent that happening in a power station where a large amount of coal is stocked, coal anti-dusting sprays are used to keep that fire from happening. And do you have any idea how much coal does a power plant consume? Let's say 200 megawatt, tiniest power plant will be 200 megawatt. How much coal does it consume per day or per hour? What is your wild guess estimate? Will it be in kilograms? Will it be in tons? How many tons? It's about 150 to 200 tons per hour that a coal based power plant consumes, even for a 200 megawatt power plant. So that huge stock they have to maintain. Obviously coal anti-dusting is very important there, and about 5% of the energy which they produce in that electrical plant, they spend in crushing that coal. Because coal is a very hard rock, and to crush it takes a lot of energy. If you spray that with water, that energy required becomes half. If you spray that with diesel, the diesel percolates better because there are a lot of hydrophobic surfaces in the coal, and diesel percolates better and it will bring it down to a fourth. But if you spray the right kind of micro emulsion, it will wet the hydrophobic part as well as the hydrophilic part, penetrates much better into that coal and brings down the force required to crush that coal tenfold. So coal crushing is a big application for those micro emulsions. Leather, I talked about degreasing. The degreasing is natural fat which is present inside the hide has to be removed. And then the formulation which is fat liquoring, the collagen matrix that remains will not sustain itself, it will be like a biscuit which will break if those fat molecules are not put back in it. The synthetic fat put back as fat liquoring again requires surfactants there. All the cosmetics that you talk of, they are emulsions, lotions of different kind, which means oil and water mixtures, and they use almost anywhere between 10 to 50% by weight in those formulations is a surface active agent, making those formulations possible. Printing inks, when you talk about, I already mentioned how stable they need to be, but when you talk about an inkjet printer printing 1200 dpi and 30 pages per minute, think about the nozzle size through which that carbon particle has to go through, think about the formulation of that ink which has to be stabilizing that tiny carbon particle in such a solvent, not water, in such a solvent that when it impinges onto that paper, before the paper comes out you want it dry. It has to within that short time penetrate the paper, stick to it firmly, and the solvent should vaporize by the time the paper comes out. Very, very difficult formulation of such an ink. And that ink has to be de-inked when you are reusing the paper. When you talk about safety and pollution abatement, firefighting foams are a very peculiar category, that the liquid that the firefighting station engine brings in is this amount. And when it is sprayed, the volume is almost going to fill up this room, and that foam which is formed in an instant when that nozzle spray happens. Not only that, that foam which is formed is supposed to remain stable at that high temperature there and cut off oxygen from burning. And all that formation of the foam, stabilization of that foam has to happen very quickly within the second of the time that the nozzle comes out. Another very unrelated application requiring something very similar is shaving foams. That tiny 100 ml bottle, when you press that, a large volume of foam comes out. That foam formation gets 0.1 seconds in that nozzle. But that foam is supposed to remain stable in contact with your skin for at least 10 to 15 minutes and lubricate the movement of the blade. Very similar to the firefighting formulation. And obviously they require very precise surfactants. In fact, firefighting formulation use a fluorohydrocarbon type of surfactants which reduce the surface tension of water, not like ordinary surfactants which will bring it down from 72 to 30, but this fluorohydrocarbon surfactant bring it down to 20, which is what is required for that. In civil engineering, so we will tell you about some of the concrete chemicals they are used, cement additives. There are materials which are used for reducing the water amount in making that cement. And why should water amount be less? If I make that cement plaster with less water amount, the final strength that it gets is very high. But if I use less water, I cannot apply that plaster, the plasticity is very low. So I need a minimum amount of water. But why is the plasticity low if water is less? That is because of interparticular friction. So I add a third party agent, which is the water reducing agent or the super plasticizer, which lubricates every cement particle and the sand particle and makes the friction less, so that even with less amount of water, I get a plasticity which I desire, and the end strength that I get is higher, and the drying time required for that concrete is also less. Those are the different additives used in civil engineering. In electronics, the cleaning that is required for semiconductor itself consumes huge amount of surfactant, and there are other uses of surfactant in that industry too. But imagine I am going to dope that semiconductor with parts per billion of something else. So how thorough a clean material that it has to be to begin with. Extremely large amount of surfactant gets used there. Explosives are materials which can burn, but an oil can burn also. Why does that not explode? It is because the oil, one part burns now, the second part burns a few seconds later, and the remaining part burns a few minutes later. If entire oil molecules collide with air at one single instant, we call it explosion. But for that to happen, it has to have the oxidant right next to the molecule. It cannot wait for the air to diffuse and reach there. And so therefore, the oxidant is dissolved in water, because that is a water soluble oxidant typically, and the oil and those droplets of oil and water have to be now so thoroughly mixed that the oxidant is next to that oil. A very, very special form of emulsion is required, because you want the exterior and the interior of your design. Normally, if I disperse 5% by volume in 95% of something, which is continuous and which is dispersed? Which one will be the dispersed phase? The 95% or the 5%? 95% will normally be the continuous phase, 5% will be the dispersed phase. But think in terms of foam. In a foam, I have created a lot of foam and I am looking at it. Which is continuous? Is the air bubble continuous? Or is it the liquid which is continuous? Air bubbles are trapped bubbles. So air pocket, another air pocket. But the liquid as a wall is continuous. And what volume fraction in foam is liquid? Very tiny. So you can indeed form a structure where volume fraction being tiny also it is continuous. Volume fraction being large is dispersed. And that is what is done in those explosive emulsions, which are known as HIPR, or high internal phase ratio emulsions. Internal phase volume fraction is high, the continuous phase volume fraction is low. Those are those emulsion explosives. All those RDX and the plastic explosives that I talk of, all are emulsion materials. And the only use is not terrorism. The use is basically a constructive use and gets misused for other activities. Let me clarify on that. Scoring of wool, I already mentioned some formulations which were used, but scoring of cotton and synthetics also is required for removal of oligomers, and those are getting removed by use of specific types of surfactants. In fact, if you look at the use of surfactant, you ask a common man about surfactant or detergent, and the only thing he or she thinks of is the clothes washing that you do at home, right? If I tell you the amount of detergent and surface active agent used in making this shirt, making is more than the amount of surfactant or detergent I am going to use during the shirt's life to wash it, you will be surprised. That amount is all used as spin finishes at various stages. There are at least 20 houses in which a spindle goes from one house to another, and the spindle, the fiber comes out, goes over hundreds of those wheels of different kind, some process is happening, and at the end of it is wound onto another wheel. Now when a fiber passes over metal, what do you think is likely to happen? What happens when one thread passes over the other thread? You never used a kite? You used to fly a kite? With that friction, what happens to the kite? The fiber gets cut. The heat melts that fiber and it cuts it. And if that happens, when this fiber is going over those spindles and the metal due to that friction and it gets cut, do you know the speed at which these fibers are going? The speed of the fiber is faster than a fast car. It will be more than 100 kilometers per hour kind of a speed, several tens of meters per second. And at that speed, there is a tremendous amount of friction which will be caused. And if there is a rupture, if there is a breakage, and it takes a few minutes, in that few minutes, how much processing would have happened which will be the loss for the production? Tremendous amount. So they cannot afford to have such a loss. So they have to lubricate that fiber with something. So they take that fiber, when it comes in, it dips into a liquid, and in that tiny fraction of a second in which it is dipping and coming out, it has to pick up a surfactant which coats its surface and lubricates it from the subsequent processes. And when this happens, there is only a tiny amount of time for that adsorption and lubrication, and it, after the process is over, before the fiber is wound onto the wheel or the spin, it has to be removed also, because the next house treatment cannot happen with that material remaining on it. So it has to be pushed through another liquid at the same high speed in which that coning oil, honing oil, all those kind of spin finishes are removed. And in the process, per weight of that shirt or the final shirt, the fiber, the amount of weight of surfactant used is much more than the weight of that cloth. And I will probably using less amount of detergent through the life to wash it than the amount of detergent used by the manufacturer to make it. Those are all the spin finishes. And I am still not talking about the dyeing process. The dyeing process has to happen in the fiber very, very uniformly. I may have a diagram or a picture of it. If the dyeing liquid does not penetrate through the fiber and it doesn't get dyed uniformly, you will have a problem. I use a white shirt, but those of you who use colored materials, so many women here, if the color does not become uniform, you will get what is known as that special kind of print. I am sure this answer will not be given by men, only girls will be able to tell me this. The special print which, it is not a uniformly colored cloth, it has blotches of those colors. The batik print, you know the batik print, or is the word wrong? I heard wrong from my wife probably. The batik print which is used for chunnis and all, where it is spots of those colors are there, and it is not, how it is done is that it is tied, the cloth is tied and then the dyeing is done. So that it is only in blotches and not in continuous color. That is what will happen to normal dyeing if surfactant is not used in it. Surfactant makes it penetrate uniformly throughout that cotton and it becomes uniformly colored. Otherwise it will be in patches of different colors. And laundering of course is what we do at home, but that is the most mundane application. Softening is something which many of us don't do, but in Western world when the cloth gets washed, it becomes rough, and to make it soft you use a cationic surfactant which adsorbs on it, and the adsorbed surfactant has the tail groups which are hydrocarbon like and which give a lubrication, and thereby we say the material has become softer. This, I had that diagram right here. The left one is a badly formulated dyeing solution. The right one, you can see the drops have completely penetrated into the cloth. I have deliberately put less number of drops so that they don't go fully, they don't spread fully, but you can see the drop which has penetrated. And this drop, if it remains like this, it will be a good material for making rain cheater, wind cheater, but not during the dyeing process. The dyeing process has to happen like the right side. This is again the contact angle of the liquid onto the fabric fiber. If the contact angle is low, it will spread uniformly. If the contact angle is large, it will roll off. This is the normal detergency or removal of dirt from any surface that we know of, but since this is the most known application, I will skip that. I probably have a photograph of yet another application, yes, here. The same pesticide spray, there is another story, another side of that story also. If I make the pesticide spray drop liquid such that it has a high contact angle with the leaf, it will, like the lower half of the leaf, it will form lenses and blobs which when the wind comes, it will fall down. If it is a nutrient or a pesticide, if the, instead of the nutrient reaching the leaf or instead of the pesticide protecting the leaf, it will go down to the weed and protect the weed rather than protecting the main crop. And the farmer will use 10 times more amount of the pesticide than what is required, and then that pesticide will land into all the water streams, and we will talk about pesticide landing in our drinking water. That is what precisely happens. That is the reason usually a farmer ends up using a lot more of the pesticide than what is really required if it is ill formulated. If the formulation spreads like that at the top on the leaf, it will be a much smaller amount which will be sufficient. So that is again the contact angle of that water on that leaf. In pharmaceutical technology, there are many drugs which need to be made soluble in water. Many times there are parenteral drugs, that means given as an injection into the blood, and blood cells pass through that capillary, but any large emulsion drop would not. So they have to be made into a micro emulsion form where the size is less, or they have to be made like a vesicle where the vesicle size is comparable to the RBC. If I put the drug into that vesicle, in fact there is another advantage which is about the toxicity of the drug. A drug which, when we take a tablet, the concentration in the blood goes high, and due to metabolism, as a function of time, the concentration comes low. So after 8 hours, I have to take another tablet. The reason is, if the concentration falls below this level, the bacteria will not get killed. And why don't I take 2 tablets so that the concentration will remain high for 16 hours? If I take double the amount, I will exceed the toxic limit of that particular molecule in my body. So I have to stay within the toxic limit and the therapeutic limit. And that's why after every 8 hours, I have to take a second tablet. But if I put it inside the vesicular, there is an advantage I will get, which is especially true for a drug called rifampicin. Rifampicin, the minimum concentration required for it to act on tuberculosis is, if it is this, the maximum concentration above which it is toxic is here. So if I use at a concentration which is below toxic, it is not effective. And if I use it at a concentration above what is required for it to be effective, it is toxic. So what do? I put it inside vesicles, so it goes into the blood and all the parts of the body see that vesicle as if it was an RBC. And only some targeted parts where I put a specific target also in it, which are tuberculoid cells, they see that it is not an RBC and they capture it. Typically, this job is usually done by liver. They will capture it, and once it is captured in the cell wall of that liver or that particular organ, the vesicle surfactant gets dissolved. And the molecule of the drug rifampicin, which is dissolved in that shell of the hydrocarbon tails, now mixes there. That concentration will be high enough for it to be active, but the rest of the blood, it was completely, all the parts of the body were completely protected, especially it has renal toxicity, that means kidney toxicity. The body is protected from that high concentration. So it's called an inverted therapeutic index that it has. For such molecules, vesicular delivery or liposomal delivery is used. So pharmaceutical applications are also many for these nanostructured materials. Many of them are controlled release formulation. I already talked about wetting of the leaf, that is foliage. But there is artificial blood also can be formed using fluorohydrocarbon microemulsions of the tiny nanometer size, which have an absorption capacity of oxygen 3 times more than normal blood. Experiments have been done on animals that you take out the blood, replace it with this fluorohydrocarbon microemulsion, the animal has survived for several hours because it was capable of absorbing the oxygen in the normal fashion through the lungs. And that is possible because of the fluorohydrocarbon microemulsion that it forms. How much time do we have? 5? We'll take a tea break at about 5-10 minutes? Okay. Fine. This is a very peculiar application. It's in combustion. And we normally think that particles cause friction. But you know that graphite particles were used as lubricants. So particles don't always cause friction. If it's sand, it will cause friction. Sand is used in the railway engines in the front to give traction. But some particles you use as lubricant on your face also. So particles can give lubrication as well. And here I am talking about a lubricant, which is a liquid lubricant used in engines. And those lubricants again are emulsions of a particular kind, which are stable only at a particular pH. If the pH becomes acidic, they lose the lubricity. And normal fuels will have, when they burn, they give carbon dioxide. Besides carbon dioxide, they will have sulfur. Now with Bharat 4 or Euro 4, you have 50 ppm sulfur. Earlier it was 150 ppm sulfur. Natural crude actually has 3 to 4% sulfur. But even the fuels that we use have 50 to 100 ppm sulfur in it. And that SO2, in the contact with metals, at that high temperature, some of it gets converted to SO3. This SO3 and the H2O, which is also there in the hydrocarbon vapor because of combustion of the hydrogen part of it, combines to give you sulfuric acid, which can get absorbed, or even the SO3 can get absorbed in the lubricant. So normally the lubricant and the exhaust gases are kept away and the exhaust gases go out separately. But in a marine diesel engine, especially the submarines, if the submarine is going to give out the exhaust gases out continuously as it moves, that is a dead giveaway for a ship on the surface as to where that submarine is. And if the ship knows where exactly the submarine is, all it needs to do is put a depth charge which will explode there, and that's the end of that submarine. So the submarine has to follow a rule which many times you will see in offices put for smokers: inhale if you must, smoke if you must, but don't exhale. Means it cannot exhale those combustion gases. If it comes out in the ocean like that, you are dead. So what do? You hold those combustion gases. And holding means around the engine crankcase where the lubricant is. Now if it has SO3 in it, the lubricant is in contact with that SO3 for a long time, it absorbs, SO3 absorbed in aqueous phase becomes sulfuric acid, it lowers the pH of the lubricant, and if the lubricant becomes acidic, it loses lubricity. Now if you want to prevent this from happening, what is done is a very peculiar thing: use of particulate matter inside that lubricant. If I have extremely tiny particles of calcium oxide which serve as a lubricant themselves also, what the calcium oxide particles will do, first of all they can react with carbon dioxide becoming calcium carbonate, or they can, even after becoming calcium carbonate, can react with SO3 to form calcium sulfate. Which means what happens to the pH? It is not allowed to drop down. It maintains the pH at a high enough value for much longer than what it was without them. But to form such tiny droplets, you have to use reactors of such kind that I will get nanoparticles of that calcium oxide and calcium carbonate. And that is done using a micro emulsion which is used as a micro reactor. I have some figures of how that is done. The two micro emulsion droplets, one containing dissolved carbon dioxide, another containing dissolved calcium oxide, calcium hydroxide that is, they come together to form that calcium carbonate particle. And the interaction between these droplets decides how large the particle would be. And they are very precisely controlled to give you very fine calcium carbonate particles in it. And then those calcium carbonate particles prevent acidity developing in that lubricant. If I have a diagram of that, no, I don't. I probably have it subsequently. What I'll do is we'll stop here. You need tea, I need tea, so we'll meet after 10 minutes. So welcome back. Okay, we're looking at applications of various nanostructured media that surfactants generate with micelles, with vesicles, with the microemulsions. Now this application I'm talking about is in petroleum. When crude oil comes out from the petroleum well, it diffuses through the rocks, comes into the production well. Normally on its own, because there is a lot of trapped gas present in that reservoir which creates pressure and pushes the petroleum to the production well. But this gas, beyond a point, starts escaping through the pores itself, and then the liquid stops coming on its own. When the liquid stops coming on its own, what is done is some well, the middle well for example, is being used as a production well, and the left side well or the right side well is used as an injection well, and you inject into that carbon dioxide. And when you push carbon dioxide into the well, it creates pressure and pushes the oil towards the production well. Beyond certain point, even the CO2 injection cannot push oil out. Then they inject water, usually sea water, into those injection wells, which is pushed, and then that pushes the petroleum oil out. But the petroleum oil reservoir, as we call, is not like a tank that on one end I push and at the other end it comes out. Oil is actually present as tiny drops all through the rock mass. So when water is pushed, water goes through some portions, leaving behind a lot of that petroleum. Typically half the petroleum is left behind in the rocks itself even after the water flooding. And that is the stage at which scientists found in late 60s that micro emulsions come in handy. And micro emulsions will have a very low interfacial tension with water, but they will be immiscible with water. The bicontinuous microemulsion. It will also have a very low interfacial tension with oil, but it will still be immiscible with that oil. So what they do is they will pump in from that injection well some amount of microemulsion. But you cannot push too much volume of it because it is expensive. So you push microemulsion bicontinuous, and behind that you push salt water, sea water, and now in between there is a plug of this microemulsion which has low interfacial tension with this side water, low interfacial tension with the oil. It can penetrate into all kinds of pores, hydrophilic or hydrophobic, and therefore push those oil droplets with the piston of this water behind it towards the production well. This is known as tertiary recovery of petroleum that becomes economically feasible at a higher price of petroleum naturally. At the basic price of petroleum it is not feasible, so many people have this tertiary oil recovery technique ready. When the prices go up they use that, when the prices are low they cannot use that. Second, in the normal drilling action also what happens is that when the oil is flowing through those capillary like tubes between the rocks, many times those rocks will create fine particles. They will break into fine particles and they will block the flow from those capillaries. And the well stops producing. At this stage, they say the well needs re-stimulation. Now, well re-stimulation means you have to go there and open those pores, take it out, take out the plug, and the oil will start flowing. Only thing, if the pores were of few meter size, somebody could have gone there and done it. These pores we are talking about are capillary size. At a height of more than 100 meters under the earth and at a temperature of more than 100 degrees Celsius. So it's not like somebody can go there and do that unplugging. So what is done is that some types of acids are poured into the injection well. Now these acids go into the rocks, and most of these rocks are carbonate type rocks. Carbonate reacts with acid, it dissolves, and when it dissolves the plugs and the fines also. And now with the pressure of the oil from the other side, it can come out. But there are two problems with it. One, if I use a mineral oil, it reacts so fast that instead of penetrating and then reacting with the walls of the tubes, it starts creating a big cavity at the injection wall, injection well point itself. So you want to retard that oil. So what they do is they make a gel, and in that gel they incorporate acid. Now this gel is pushed under pressure into the injection well. So as a result, from the gel the acid has to diffuse and reach to the wall of that capillary, and that much time is available for you to push that gel. But if that gel is a polymeric gel, even after the acid acts onto the wall, the gel will remain there. And now instead of the particles blocking, the gel will block the flow of petroleum. So that gel is made out of surfactants which form long chain micelles, the cylindrical micelles, which entangle and give it high viscosity and makes it a gel. But these long chain micelles, when they come in contact with the oil itself, the petroleum oil, that dissolves into the micelle. And this cylindrical micelle, when it dissolves oil, it becomes spherical micelle. And when it becomes a spherical micelle, the viscosity drops drastically, it's no longer a gel, and now this easy flowing liquid can come out with the push of the petroleum oil back to the production well, or back through the injection wells also. And the re-stimulation of the well happens. That means I have pushed that acid and now oil has started coming back from it. So this is how you make those gels using surfactants or acid stimulation, re-stimulation of the well. But there are some holes which are already producing oil. If you push acid gel over there, what can happen is that those holes become bigger. Now, surface area of anything per unit volume is higher if the size is smaller. If you make it into a larger pore, the surface area per volume is less. So the oil production will drop down. So what you have to do is formulate a blank gel which is pushed into whatever pores which are open. Then the acid gel is pushed. When it stops at the blocked points of the particles, the acid acts on those particles, dissolve them, and the gel goes further. The blank gel on the other hand, when it goes into these points, it will stop there, but in the pores which are already open, the gel goes inside. Now the subsequent gel with acid which I am putting, I have protected those pores which were already open. and after a few hours or a few days at that high temperature, when oil comes into contact, the oil dissolves and both the gels will flow out from the re-stimulated well. So, well re-stimulation, acid retardation and protection of those pores which are not blocked, all is done using particular types of gels which are made with petroleum sulfonates, dialkyl quaternary ammonium compounds, and these materials are known as plugging agents, drilling fluids of all different kinds used in petroleum operations, petroleum being brought out from the earth's crust. In yet another very interesting application that we had studied in our lab, and the talk that I give with this work alone, the title I give is, can water help fuel burn? Normally water is used as an extinguishing material instead of helping the fuel burn, but can water help fuel burn? And we looked at two major issues, beginning with what happens in rural domestic usage of a fuel. One of the very commonly used rural domestic fuel, besides of course wood, is kerosene. And there are two problems which we noticed with kerosene. When kerosene is stored in tanks, either at home or in the tankers, you will have liquid and then you have air. That air will have vaporized hydrocarbon present in that, and now it's a mixture of air and hydrocarbon. This is an explosive mixture. Any accidental fire, friction, spark that happens there, it causes a vapor cloud explosion. Liquid burning is like candle burning. It's called pool burning, which is a very controllable process. Whereas vapor cloud explosion is virtually uncontrollable, instantaneous, and causing a lot of damage. It can happen in an upturned tanker on the road. It can happen.